bunch of trees in Raleigh last week, so we cut them down. I have copies.
I got one, huh?
Yep.
I got a good one.
You got one, Frank?
Oh, sorry.
I've also got copies of the budget reports. SA 56 and for the town. Does anybody need copy, hard copies?
Sorry, can I displace you?
No, no.
SA 56?
Yes. I'll show you where it is.
That is SA 56.
I think it's.
The budget.
The school one.
And multiple. There's three, basically this document that.
I have one. I printed all of myself.
There's one for the school if you need it.
Yeah.
You might need the school.
Yes, I do.
Town. That's what the town one. Said I didn't need one, but we have extras because of people.
I hear she's good. You're not taping yet, right?
Cory, you need a sound?
All right.
So these are water and sewer.
Oh, yeah, I have that.
What's in the format?
Anybody need these?
No.
The town?
No, thank you.
Anybody need town?
No, thank you.
I'll take everything.
And this is the.
Oh, it's different.
I don't think.
It should be.
Guys, I think that.
Three pieces from the town.
Yeah, it looks like the school, SAU one came in two pieces.
I have one that's 10 pages for the town.
Yeah, you should have.
Those are the expense appropriations. Then there's a two-page, a three-page revenue, and then like an executive summary.
Put two off together.
No.
Not stapled together, no, they're three different pieces.
Here's. Here's the summary.
See, there's two pages in the summary.
I see.
And here's revenue, there's one revenue left.
Right, left.
And then there's.
Yeah, can I get a revenue?
This is all page one of two, so I think one of you.
Are these the same documents?
Can I have a page two of two? Oh, it's on the back.
Yeah.
You got the second school one?
I'm sitting in the back row.
I can give you a little light reading.
I have it if that's what you sent. Nope.
All right. So it's 6:30, 1 or 2. We'll call meeting to order. Thanks, everybody. Just check to see who we've got. Bill is here. Nancy's here. Kim is excused. Charlie's here. Paul Cass is not here. Jody is excused. Ed is not here. Emily's here. Frank's here. Suzanne's here. So Cory, just for your notes, both Kim and Jody were excused.
And Paul.
And Paul and Ed.
Yes.
Before we jump into the minutes, I just wanted to talk a little bit about how I plan to run meetings. I don't think we need to go into a strict Roberts Rules type of thing where everybody talks through me. So as long as everybody is respectful and waits to be called upon to speak and doesn't cross-talk, we'll keep it that way, less formal. But if it gets sort of out of control, we can institute more formal procedures. Is that okay with everybody? Great. All right, so the first item is the minutes from our last meeting, which was April 18th. Cory, you want to?
I have it.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
I circulated earlier today, just some typos. I don't know if everybody got those. There was nothing that changed the content or meaning or anything.
What was the blue? It was the red marks and all the blue marks.
For some reason, my computer sometimes thinks that I'm John, and sometimes it thinks I'm Jonathan.
Okay.
And so when I'm editing stuff, sometimes it's one color and one's another color.
So I should assume they're the same.
When I got it, I didn't get any of the, it didn't show any of the red or the blue on mine on the iPad.
Oh, yeah, iPad doesn't do that. Yeah, that's the, I have that problem too. Do we want to, we'll start with anybody who has any questions or comments.
Can I just ask, I was not here, but we did have an official person, and that was Denise Knowles, and so if Denise could be included in this conversation about the minutes.
Yes, that's, sounds good to me.
Just on who was present, Michelle's not on the top part of.
Again?
I think this is a recurring thing.
It is a recurring thing. Thank you for missing me. I miss that.
I didn't see that either. I went right to the meat of it.
Corey, I think you have a block.
Well, I'm surprised. Because I must have written you in and then deleted when you weren't chair. Because I had to put in. So I usually copy and paste over.
It was just on the top part. The rest of it, the rest of it, you have her in all the rest of the minutes. It's just the who was present.
I just copied from old minutes, the standard, and I had to delete because you were no longer chair. So yeah, no, I'm gonna go with
no problem.
Yeah.
Does anybody have any other questions or comments? Then we have a motion to.
I would make a motion to accept the minutes.
Second.
As edited or corrected.
And second.
And all in favor, say aye.
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 And opposed? Good. So we've accepted the minutes. While we're on minutes, I don't think last time we were here we had minutes from the prior meeting.
They're done. I just want to know what to do with them. Like, I'll send them in after we're done here, but should I send them to the town clerk or? How should, because we never decided what I do. Do I upload them to the town or?
Yeah, that was an open issue on here too.
What minutes are you talking about?
Well, we didn't approve or review any minutes in the last meeting. So
the deliberative session.
Oh, but there have been two meetings already, is that?
No, the deliberative session and the budget workshop in January.
That's a different budget committee though.
Yeah, I know.
So I don't know that we have any.
So we just leave it
this. I think last year I can go back and I think the first meeting with Alan Robinson, we approved them.
That's quite possibly so, nonetheless, I repeat.
Should I upload them? Or?
Yes, you can just say upload it as taken by Corey Jones. I mean, I don't know.
Well, I guess what I saw of watching a video of a flyer, not that I would spend all my time watching videos of prior meetings, but I wanted to know what to expect. At that time, I think the people who weren't there just abstained from voting because they weren't part of it at the time. And that way, those who were there could at least check to see that it was accurate. And it seems like that makes sense.
Because I don't know how you would approve anything from February on because might be a new budget committee.
Judith, you were there, so.
I don't know if this will be helpful or not. I heard Corey say from the deliberative session.
Yeah.
Corey took those notes as the school district clerk. So those
the
do not.
February 10th minutes. I have to figure out what it's called.
Okay.
Public hearing.
Oh, okay. All right.
So we're not. So why don't you put those, send those around, and we'll just look at them at the next meeting and.
All right. Yeah. I don't want them just to go on.
While Denise is here, we did talk about finding out a little more about what we need to do in terms of posting. Did you learn anything more about that?
No. Who does Corey send them to, Suzanne, so they can get posted online to the website?
You sent a link to me earlier. Should I do it through that?
So, what other committees do, and what I had suggested to this committee like several years back, but the chair at the time didn't like the idea, is that there is a drive, there is a folder, a little drive called Budget Committee.
Yeah.
And just as there is for the Historic Committee and the Recreation Committee. And those bodies have a subfolder called Minutes. And they file their own minutes in there. Mm-hmm. They just upload them. So one process that this budget committee could choose to do is to have Corey upload them, say, you know, right at the top line, in the title even, draft. But once they're in there, they're going to be available to the public, and that's not a bad thing.
Sure.
Right? So he can upload them as soon as they're ready, say draft in the title, on the top of the first page, however. And then once this body, then this body can look at them online and using, you know, suggestions, if you've got Google, you can either make your own suggestions there or bring them on paper. And then once we've approved them, or you can then make them. And then if they're on the Google Drive, they will never go away. They're available to the town clerk, et cetera, et cetera.
I think that the problem, the reason why, is because you have an AOL account, correct? Do you have a Google account?
I have an AOL account.
Okay. That was one of the questions too, is because she hasn't got a, she has to have a Google account to be able to get into the drive. No?
Not being the expert at Google, but I think that
we can. Okay.
I need paper. I don't have a laptop, and I still have AOL.
I access
Google Docs for my kids' school stuff using my Comcast account, so you should be able to do it.
It's okay. Open to the public.
Yeah, I think the
folder is open to the public, so unless there's some particular configuration that you might have that we can help you with, you should be able to see them. That doesn't mean that you have to make edits online. You can bring them on paper, or you can make them online the way Jonathan did, you know, et cetera, et cetera. But that avoids.
I'd like to be able to use technology to everybody can just edit one thing, and we're not making Corey try and put everything together. We're in a meeting, and we're not talking about five different versions of an edit. That'd be nice to sort of.
I think you have to have a Gmail to upload for. Mm-hmm. But not. I think you can you can download, but you can't upload. You have to give it access.
Which is.
But it doesn't. I don't have to do that.
We just need to get it access so you can review it.
Yeah, I already have the access.
I have a Gmail account. That's what I use for the community guide.
Oh, okay.
And our obligation is by leaves after the meeting to have it available.
The draft up and available.
So somehow, you know, in the town hall or somewhere.
So I think that's what we gotta do.
Is there a way for him to put draft down the body?
His
version now has drafts for across
the watermark.
And it can say unapproved budget, because once it's either approved or it's not approved.
Yeah, I can put that like at the top, like
unapproved by the budget committee.
Yeah.
Unapproved minutes or whatever.
Yeah. Subject to approval. Yeah, so.
Any other thoughts or comments on that?
I would be happy to resend the link to the folder and the entire folder as well as the minutes folder. So
I've been on and I just noticed that all the minutes weren't there. So that was the I think for this budget committee, I'd like it if you could use that.
While we're on that, who would update the page for the budget committee, because it's still Liz Michelle as the chair and Vern and so forth.
I would be happy to let Tina know.
Okay.
We have, if you go into the budget folder, the on Google Drive, and somewhere there's a subfolder that says membership.
Yeah.
If you look at that, you'll see that that's correct.
Okay.
My thought, I haven't been able to convince our webmaster, is to just point to that. You know, it makes a better page if you could list them there, but then you have to update that page.
Right.
And so if you could just link to the membership page that's on Google Drive, you'll see those of us who are on it when our terms expire. It doesn't yet, it may say who's chair. I may have done that. I think, because you are chair and you are vice chair, I believe, Bill.
Yes.
So I think the Google Drive is okay. Then I'll let Tia know to update the page. although my preference would be to have a link to the Google Drive.
Just makes for a poor user experience.
When you do it, what?
Link to the, it should be updated, that shouldn't be.
I will have her updated.
It should be something that our team provides for also.
It's not hard, it's not the hardest thing.
It should be a volunteer.
Okay, so the next item I had was the meeting schedule, and actually I didn't have that printed out here, so I printed it out. And I sent this along electronically.
Sorry, I have the elevations. Somehow mine came a lot smaller than this.
The reason is that I had a comment that I've taken off of there. So when it has comments, it shrinks a little. What I did to create this is I just followed the schedule from last year, changing the dates just to be the Wednesday, so it was otherwise the same day as the first cut. The thing that's tricky about this is that now that we have SB2 for the town, we have to do a deliberative session, another deliberative session for the town budget. And I think we could do it a couple of different ways. One way would be to have everything in one day, to deliberative sessions in the same day. Some towns apparently do that, but that makes everybody kind of hurry.
Would you say Frankie?
Frankie.
Why word exactly?
It's too much. And I've had conversations with the moderator, who also is concerned that that's too much to keep track of. And by the time you're done, he's spent, and it's hard to keep up with not one of six. So the way I've got shown here is two separate sessions, one for the, just like we would do before for the school board and town meeting. It's just that we're going to be in February. The deliberative session for, there's 1 week that's allowed. It's the first and second Saturdays following the last Monday in January, inclusive of those Saturdays. And so the first Saturday I picked for school and the second Saturday I picked for town. One of the questions I had when I sent this around was, because the town one is on the last Saturday, what happens if we don't give a snow day? And I actually contacted Margaret at New Hampshire Municipal Association, and she thought that she interpreted that as long as we had a makeup for a snow day, a weather day within 72 hours, we would be okay.
Really?
Yeah, so we could do just like we did before, the makeup could be the Tuesday following. That's why yours has shrunk up and mine isn't anymore, because I took away and added the snow day for that following Tuesday, which is the same way we've done the other deliberative sessions. But having presented that, I'll open up.
That's a great idea, because my only suggestion was Saturday, Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday.
Yeah.
You know?
That's what I was thinking too.
Because, so if in fact that the Saturday that you originally chosen for the town, if we can reschedule within 72 hours, then big yay. That's helpful.
Is that cast in stone? I mean, do we need to get that in writing? Because, there's been all these issues with,
elections and
people changing and so forth, and just trying to be on the safe side. Is that an official opinion that we have so we can go forward and do that? Or do we want to just say?
I have it in writing, and I have references to the statutes that she takes it from. I mean, other than, with any lawyer, they're going to say it's an opinion. We'll hold up in court. I don't know if there's precedent or anything like that, but
no. If you got something in writing with references, I'm good. It's so that it's more than a phone call.
And I just got this afternoon. I'll forward it to the rest of the committee so you can see it.
I think you should put the snow days on the schedule.
Yeah, I did.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I didn't.
Know. I added the one I had. I had one missing, and I added it because I wasn't sure what to do with it before. But the new version I just passed around has a snow day It doesn't have snow days for.
That's the new version.
Oh, okay.
What, commentary?
I know, and I was like, I don't think I know what that word means. But yeah, cemetery.
Okay, I'll talk to my.
First reading.
I'll talk to my word processing expert on that one.
What's commentary? For the longest time, I was trying to figure it out.
You're right.
Then I realized.
Any other questions or comments? I had one other question, but I wanted to let people.
I have some comments about the descriptions for some of these.
Okay.
This is a joke for me to just kind of hold forth a little bit.
That's fine, sure.
All right, so the first one is, and this, there's some ensuing date issues that come from some of these as well. My first one is the item that says BC workshop. So my understanding of that meeting has been, even though the very, very first time I sat on this board, I was wrong with what I said, but it is the time at which the board finalizes, this committee, I'm sorry, finalizes the operating budgets that it's going to present at the public hearings. So really, I would not like it, I would like it not to be called a workshop. It is when the budget committee finalizes the operating budgets presented at the school, town, and water and sewer district public hearings. That's, and it, you know, maybe you want more than one meeting, maybe not more than one meeting to do that, I don't know, but the budgets that are presented at the public hearings by the budget committee should represent the public committee's.
So do you have language to suggest?
I said, meeting to finalize budgets to present at school, town, and WSD public hearings. Is that how you refer to yourself, Frank? Is it WSD, is that the right? Water and Sewer District?
Water and Sewer District, RWSD.
RWSD, okay, thank you.
To multiple.
Can you give that to Corey so he can?
I would be happy to.
Does anybody have any, it sounds good to me.
Meetings.
More description.
Oh, what you were just talking.
Yeah, what I just said. I just said it, yeah, okay.
Now, I have a question. If we have to have a meeting after the meeting because we didn't get it all done, do we have to give X number of days notice of that meeting?
I think so, yeah.
And how many days is that?
Suzanne, I'm guessing 7 days, but Suzanne, what's that?
24 hours.
That one is the 24 hours.
Yeah, so meetings of committees are 24 hours.
Right, so it's not a
hearing.
Public
hearings are 7 days. And the other thing, okay, as long as we're talking about public hearings, the thing to remember is that they have to be 7 clean, clear, whatever term is, days. So if the notice is happening here on this date, and the meeting is, the public hearing is happening here on this date, they have to be 7 days in between those two dates. Okay. So you can't just take 5, add 7, and come to 12.
Right.
They have to be 7. The end dates, the notification date, and the meeting date itself do not count as part of the 7 days.
Got it.
But aren't all the meetings public?
All meetings are public. Mm-hmm. All meetings of public bodies are public.
So the only difference is a public hearing. You lost me there, because I thought we've been doing a week for all meetings we've been noticing.
Public hearings. Not all public hearings are different from meetings.
Correct.
Of committees or commissions or whatever. So my understanding, the Select Board, for example, is okay giving a 24 hours notice. Because sometimes we have special meetings, and that is sufficient. If we were to hold a public hearing on our, because we've updated our 10-year road plan, and we want to hold a public hearing, we need to have 7 clear days to let people know. If we're planning a change to our town ordinance on the transfer station, we need to provide 7 days notice for what is a public hearing, as opposed to a meeting of a public body to which the public can attend, not necessarily participate.
I mean, in the past, it's been correct.
Yeah.
All right. I just want to make sure, because I was scrambling last year and called on the carpet because I didn't have the 7 days.
Right. I had the same question about that, and I what I found all I could find was the hearings having the 7-day.
I just referred to the ordinances recently, because like, over the water and sewer, a lot has changed, and that 24-hour thing is exactly what I found too.
That's what the school board does.
And then I, and then I called, but they want you to do 24 or more, as many hours as possible, so that as soon as you know that you have to reschedule it, it's kind of your obligation to give them as much time as they can, because they, you could be considered, you know, shading, trying to put together a shading meeting. So as soon as you, you know, you had a weather, you know, a weather event, it was canceled, or whatever happened. If you had a meeting that was canceled, you have to reschedule it as soon as.
So in practice, it's probably good to give a week's notice, and if we can do that, great. But if we have, and now that we have a schedule, we're doing at least that. But when we have a special meeting or something that's not.
The public hearings on the budgets, for example.
Right.
We need 7 clean days.
Right. Okay.
But not a board meeting.
Not a meeting.
Not a committee meeting. Okay, I see lots more scribbles on there, Suzanne. What's your next one?
So, my next one is, let me see if I can understand my own notes. So, where it says school public hearing, what I would suggest is the budget committee public hearing on the school operating budget / warrants, because that's what it's the public hearing. It's about the school operating budget / warrant, and it clearly states that it's the budget committee's public hearing. The one right under that is where we just got into some, you know, Corey and I, Corey and Judy, had caused miscommunication. That BC deliberative session, really, I don't feel it's wise to call it a deliberative session. So you could say, this is the meeting after the public hearing, you know, the budget committee holds its public hearing, and then the budget committee stays on to deliberate, you know, or meet, or talk about. But if you could call it something like the budget committee finalizes its recommendations on the operating budget and warrants. That's what that, isn't that what that meeting does?
But isn't this
it is not the deliberative session.
Then what's the deliberative
session? The deliberative session is the one that's has to be held, you know, within the three.
It's the deliberative session. Yeah, got it. Sorry, I was confusing them. Thanks.
It is confusing to use that term.
Yeah, I just grabbed what was there for last year.
Is that the one that you take the public input and then reconsider the budget with public input?
It's what?
Yes.
What you?
Yeah.
Yes.
So,
I'll just leave it at that. Yes.
So I'm all for clarifying the title there. I think that's helpful. Corey, have you captured that?
I got it.
The same would be true then for for the town one. So it would be the budget committee's public hearing on the town's operating budget / warrants. And then afterwards, it would be the budget committee's finalizes recommendations on the operating budget / warrants.
On which you last me on that.
Pardon?
You had 2 lines. Which one are we looking at?
Well, the
deliberative
two,
session.
Well, so if you look at
January 12th.
Yes. Yes. So the one after January, January 12th. So first it's the budget committee's public hearing on the budgets, operating budget / warrants. And then the one right underneath it is the budget committee needing to finalize the recommendations on the operating budget. So those are the distinctions of those two meetings. And we have to add the water and sewer, which we don't have anywhere on this. Now, we've done it in the past, the same day we do the town. So that would be what you have, you know, what you have listed here is January 12th, right? So you could just add, you know, if we wanted to continue to do the water and sewer on the same day, just make sure, because we, it has been an afterthought, unfortunately, sometimes. We've come close and we say, oh my God, we've got to do the water and sewer district, so it'd be nice to get it on the list.
I agree, and so we can just add similar language for those that just have the same date as the.
As the town, sure.
I agree with that.
You know, in the past, I think we've started with the water district because it's generally shorter, so that can be up to the, we don't think, kind of, that we need to make that distinction today.
And the town tends to be a little bit shorter than the school, so those two together make sense then.
Maybe. Kind of depends. I do have some other comments.
Keep them rolling.
They are, well, they're date related. So, for example, what you have is the budget committee workshop, which I'm suggesting we say is the budget committee meeting to finalize its presentation of budgets. You have that listed for January 9th. And yet, that is after the public hearing, the budget committee's public hearings for the school. So I don't, that seems to be a problem. Do you see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
I don't know what I did there.
Excuse me.
I think I just intended to grab whatever dates we had on the prior one and shift it a day, so I didn't really go through both.
It may be that the budget committee's public hearings for the school and the town need to get pushed further into January.
It's also possible that I've made a mistake.
It is a lot.
Yes.
That's good.
I think someone made a mistake in the alarm.
I have to get to my therapist again. I'll take a look at that. But do you have a suggested alternative?
I don't think. If there's a.
There was a crunch, though.
Yeah, oh, there's going to be a crunch this year.
Right.
I'm terrified, but we're not talking about my terror moment. I don't know that there's a requirement for a certain space of time between the public hearings and the deliberative session. So I'm wondering if we could just move, you know, maybe very early in January, hold the workshop, what has been called a workshop, the meeting where we say, okay, these are the budgets that we're going to present. And give us time, if we needed more than one, to maybe come back either the next day or the day after or something like that. And then make the schools, you know, be, you still need 7 days, you think about this. Do they need 7 days to have the information? So my question is, the question I'm wrestling with is, okay, the budget committee, we get together, we say, okay, this is the school's, this is the budget that we're going to present to the school. It's happening on this date, and we've notified this date, but, and it has a clean 7 days. Do they have to see that budget also before those 7 days? Or do we just present it the day of?
Would that be in that document you sent, the Department of Administration?
Probably not. That was more just a schedule that had some references to it. Maybe.
I can check with the municipal association.
Yeah, maybe it makes sense to table this for right now, and then we'll just
look for more information.
Revisit the dates, and then put them around to everybody. I don't think we need to necessarily have that nailed down today.
It's a good starting point.
Very good starting point.
Thank you, John.
Make sure we nail down as our next meeting.
That one we can do.
Beyond that.
Yeah. Anybody have any issues with the quarterly meetings that I put in there? That's okay. I think everybody's, some days people aren't going to be able to make it, and some days they are, but. And there was just, those again were following the dates that we had last year.
Very good effort.
Thanks. Another question is, do we now I know we work on this, do we need to go back to department heads to say, hey, these times that we're planning for you to meet, do you agree with them, or do we just sort of set it and go?
The board has already sent to department heads and cemetery trustees and library trustees an email. I did send it out, didn't I, Denise? Yeah, because the board talked about needing information sooner. Not just because of SB 2, but that was a major contributing factor. And so we are asking to have departmental budgets and from the trustees by the end of September the latest. So at least to present to us and so that we can work on our stuff. So if you were to send out an email reminder on October 17th when they were going to present, I think that should be fine. And the order is what they expect. I mean, there's no change in how they've done it in the past. I think that December 19th is a heavy lift, but if the committee is okay with doing all of those, you know, we'll do all of those. And the town will be ready to do them. Just a lot there.
Wait, what we did last year, all right?
We did. I mean, we've been doing it that way. We didn't hold a public hearing on the CIP last year. I'm hoping that perhaps this year we will be able to. So that will give some people ahead of time, including budget committee members, the opportunity to come listen to what the CIP is up to and doing. So that'll be helpful. We're hoping to have an update and a public hearing on the 10-year road plan. So again, that will give this group and public a chance to take a look at that. So those are kind of really big pieces that are part of the town's budget. So.
Right. So that's outside of?
That's outside of the, those will be our public hearings. We'll be announcing them.
Great. Okay. So that brings us to, unless anybody has anything more on the schedule, I think we're good there. Brings us to review of the budget reports. And the way, what I've asked for is that the representatives give an overview, sort of bottom line, where are we, what are the line items of maybe some concern or that might be off track. I'd rather not read through each budget item line by line together. We don't have to. So. Let's start with that, and we'll start with the town. If you see any of this.
So, for those of you who are used to seeing the board reports, usually it all comes in one workbook, and for various physical reasons, I just wasn't able to do it this year. So, you've got one 10-page report on the expense appropriations. And the operating budget is not the final line. You want to look up several sections to see the operating budget. Do people understand what I mean? So, because the operating budget is about 21.4% expended. Corey, can I just move that for just a minute? Thank you. No, the 10-page. I mean, if you look at the very bottom line, page 10 of 10, it looks like we've expended about 18.8% of the budget.
Yeah.
But that's misleading because that has the capital reserve and the capital projects that we haven't spent. So go back to page 9 of 10, and it should be the last line. It's row 268. So it says we've expended 21.4% of our budget. So, you know, just looking at that as a big number, we're okay. But there are still some things that I would like to point out that we are concerned about or that we feel good about. And they are in the report, but I'll walk through it. And so if there are questions, please do feel free. They're not in the order in which you will see them in the report. So one issue has to do with welfare and general assistance. We are dealing with quite an intractable case. It's been the most complex and expensive since I've been on the board. And it has caused us to expend 57% of our rental assistance. We are hoping this is coming to a conclusion, so we're not revising any of those budgets just yet. And for all of us, it's a reminder, whether you're new or not, in that general welfare section, the very first line says community assistance, $7,000. And what we do with that money is provide, I guess, donations, assistance to groups that supply us with help. So community partners, A Safe Place, Cornerstone V&A. And for those of you who were at the budget workshop, those are all quite legitimate expenses for this body to make. But we've always said we're not going to spend that $7,000 here at the end. So that's where our stopgap is, or our backup is, in case welfare goes crazy. And this is the first year where, you know, we might need to use that money if we can't resolve this case as quickly as I think we can. So that's welfare. That's one issue that we're watching. We see that utility expense, yes, of course.
Do you have any semblance of an idea of what we could be looking at in terms of expenditure liability for this?
Depends how long the case is unresolved.
Okay. So
we're waiting. I can't, as you can understand, I can't say too much. It's a little bit like special ed.
Yeah.
There are a lot of privacy issues. It has an order of magnitude less than special ed. I mean, special ed can get into the six digits in a hurry.
Right.
This is not going to do that, but this is a case that we have not seen the like of. So I'm hoping next quarter that I can tell you it's been resolved, and maybe we will need to rebudget something. Maybe we'll say let's keep going because we think we're going to be okay. But utility expenses, electricity and fuel in particular. Prices have gone up, and you will see that in the trend under, if you look at general, the government building. So if you look at the lines, the section starts with row 74. And if you look at 2017 and 2018, you'll see that we're spending at a higher rate. And I asked Caroline and me, unit costs have been going up, so the rack cost for fuel is up, fuel oil is up, and the cost of electricity is up, so we're spending more. So we've chosen not yet to rebudget. We're going to watch and see what second quarter looks like and see if we actually have to revise our budget. The next bullet, personnel administration, so that would be line 60. So Paycheck Services, the company that handles our payroll, so they issue payroll checks, do direct deposit for employees that do direct deposit, and we have spent 43.7%. And the first quarter is always a little bit higher because they also do our W-2s for our employees. But we had an issue with retirement and FICA, which I will talk about probably in the next section, and that caused us to have to do some corrections, and those are expensive. So I asked Caroline to give them a holler and see if she could figure out what we might be looking at for the entire year, and where we have $4,900 budgeted, they're thinking, Caroline's thinking $5,500. So you'll probably see a budget revision next month for that, but we didn't do it for this month, next quarter. All right, so here's the problem where we did have to revise budgets. So to get yourself oriented, if you're new, there's two.
Are we still on the FICO or on this payroll services? Are we on to another?
We're on to the next one, but it's related.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'll hold the question.
Oh, what are we going to ask?
It sounds like the FICA thing's a one-off, right? I mean, do next year bumping the number up, or is this sort of a?
We are going to be needing to bump the number up in the two categories I'm about to tell you about. So payroll taxes in the executive section, which covers, let's see,
payroll taxes.
Nine. Okay, so that has been, we have revised the budget for that from $2,250 to $4,848. I'm going to tell you why, and then I'm just going to point out the other one. The other one's in highway. So it would be
178, I believe.
Thank you, 178. It went from 29, about $2,500 to like $8,500. So here is the issue that occurred. And it is what we are going to face it next year because it was an error on our part.
I see.
So up until we put our prior road agent into the retirement system, our only experience with the retirement system was with the police. They weren't our only full-time employees, but the town had not put our road agent, who was a full-time employee, in the retirement system. And when that particular board saw that, they thought that was just not fair. And so we placed our road agent, who works full-time, in the retirement system. The road agent and our administrative assistant, in other words, anyone who's not a police or a fire person, is in the group one. Teachers in group one, I believe. And so we were duly paying into the retirement system the 11 point whatever percent that group one people pay, it's like 28 point something for police, and paying the 1.45% for Medicare, but not paying any FICA because we didn't do it for the police. And the National Retirement System didn't tell us anything. And so we were, you know, merrily rolling along. Fortunately, our auditor, you know, he does absolutely everything every year. But when he was doing the audit this year, he saw that we were not taking up FICA for these group one employees, when in fact, we should have been taking up FICA. So these revised budgets that you see for those two lines are permanent. We're going to have to continue them. So they're not one-off. What is one-off is we had two payroll runs already before the auditor told us about this. So we did not, the board thought it was not fair to take that out of the employee's paycheck. So we've covered the employee's part of those two payroll checks. So our part of the FICA that we missed and their part of the FICA that we missed. The prior year is coming out of fund balance. And the auditor, Tom Dumay, will be issuing W-2s for the employees to resubmit. It's not income, so it has no impact on their IRS taxes. However, they will want to make sure that their Social Security reflects the fact that they earned that amount of money, which it would not otherwise. So we still have to do that. He's been busy with tax season, so we're hoping it's worthy to do that. So unfortunately, that was not a fun thing to discover, but we will have to keep that in mind, and those lines will always be higher than they have been, so they are not one-offs. Those are the only three things that where we've revised the budget. One is the contingency, that was the funding source. So the contingency budget was refunded to add to the payroll tax lines for the executive session in the highway department.
Go ahead.
I got a quick question. Is there any penalties for this?
No.
Thank God.
I mean, the penalty is that, you know, we're spending money that we didn't think.
No, I understand
yeah,
that.
Yeah, but as far as a fine goes, yeah, no.
Good.
Any other questions on that?
Hey, can I just add one thing? The three employees who were affected were all very gracious when we talked to them, because of course this means less in their take home. Now it's going into accounts with their name on it, but you know, still it's less in their take home pay. And all three of them were very gracious about I just wanted to make sure that you understood that.
I had a couple of questions, just because I'm new to looking at the budget, so, anyways. So, line 24, is reimbursable expenses?
Yes. What the hell is that?
Thank you.
I had a question too.
We've had trouble with that over the years, explaining this away. So, and our auditor has not given us any other way to manage this. So, as if you attended the budget workshop, you know that we can only spend what we're authorized to spend. So, you know, if you are on a rampage tonight, you destroy all of the stop signs in town, we have to replace them, that money, we're gonna charge you, and you're gonna have to give us the money for them. But we still have to pay them for our budget, and we can't, the revenue that you're giving us doesn't offset it. Offsets it in the big picture in fund balance.
Okay.
But we cannot spend any more than what is on this budget line. So we use the reimbursable expenses for bank checks that aren't good, and we have to pay a fee to the bank. They're gonna reimburse us.
Right.
So it eventually doesn't always wash out. We also sometimes insurance payments, we will have an accident, and the insurance company may give us we have to pay for to repair the vehicle. They may give us the money the next year, so it doesn't happen this year. So that's the nature of those. If we could find another way to account for them.
Well, it makes sense now that you described it.
Yeah,
I totally understand, but.
So it's in addition to the budget now, just look at it that way.
It's got revenue offsetting it.
Right.
Yes.
That we weren't counting on.
Well,
or were we counting on it?
Well,
it just allows you to.
It just allows us to.
Oh, we were counting on it. It is part of the budget.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, it was a little bit higher. Like if we're looking at it quarterly, it was at 48%, but it seems like it's almost a random thing. It's not a routine thing,
yes. And we'd like to, you know, we learned about revolving accounts at the, if you recall, and, you know, they may give us an opportunity to, you know, if we have the time and the resources, maybe setting up a revolving account for those kinds of things might be a way to manage that that's better than this. But right now, we don't know of any other way to say, look, we have to spend this much money. We did get it reimbursed, but we have to spend it.
Right, and we have to spend from an item or category
that's there, yeah.
Were you done? I don't want to cut you off, because you had a list, right?
Well, I can share. Go ahead.
Are you sure?
Yeah.
So Dan, what about the voting booth? I'm sorry, line 40,
yes,
which goes with that assuming.
Yes, more than what we expected.
Yeah. Well, what does it even mean? Is that
elections and registrations?
So
because the program is up here.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
So what is that?
So last fiscal year, we bought one of those voting booths that where four people can stand and vote, and you know we had it over there, and our town clerk said it would be really helpful to have another one just for throughput, and so we ordered it. I've asked Caroline to check with her to see why it was a little bit more expensive than we thought, but that's what it is. We bought a second one. So in March, if you recall, we had one there and one there, and that's the second one is we bought with this year's money. The programming, as long as we're in this section, it may be too early to talk about it. We are going to, if you look at line 33, programming and printing ballots, mm-hmm. we're going to have to budget that more next year because we'll have more to program because all of our warrants, with SB2, all of our warrants have to be on the printed ballots and they have to be programmed. So those are two expenses that we haven't had before. So the length of our warrant, of the town warrant, will affect both the programming costs as well as the printing costs. We don't pay for printing the state and federal ballots. We do pay for programming them, though. So this year we have just, so this year we do have three elections, but only one where we have to pay for the printed ballot. That was in March, that's all.
Okay.
I have a couple more things on my list that I can talk about if I can.
Can I just go back to the reimbursable expenses? This is what's expended out. Where does it have, do you have any place in your revenues that it actually shows that any of it has come back in yet? I was trying to thumb through that when we changed to a different.
Do you have a revenue sheet? Yeah, two pages.
On page two.
Yeah, I was just getting to the part when she had changed, and then we had changed to a different one.
So you would see some under restitution. I see I don't have any numbers, I'm sorry. So you would see something under restitution, which we don't have any yet.
Mm-hmm.
You would see some of it under reimbursements, town expenses. If you look at miscellaneous revenues,
mm-hmm.
Near the bottom of page two,
yes,
that's where you would see it, and we have not received any revenue yet.
Okay. So right now they're all just expenses.
Right now they're all just expenses, yeah. If I may, I'll just point out a couple of other things while you're thinking of questions. The highway department, you know, at this point last year, we had expended, you know, almost 39% of the budget. This year, about 27%. Now, it's a bigger budget, of course, because we are a full-time person, but really, we're very pleased with the winter and the minimal, you know, the more efficient use of salt that the highway department did. So if you look at the salt line itself, it is much lower percentage-wise. It would be, row 194.
Mm-hmm.
We had overexpended, by this time last year, we had overexpended the salt budget. And this year we've got 56% expended. And most of it happens, most of our spending happens in January through mid-April. There's less, you know, hopefully, but you never know. So that, I just wanted to point that out. We're really pleased with our highway department staff. Transfer stations. So there are some things happening with municipal solid waste, and we're watching things closely. We haven't revised any of the budgets, but a hauling line, we have two hauling lines. One of which is part of the contract we have to haul materials, you know, our trash that gets compacted to Turnkey in Rochester. We have, since I have been on the board, let me stay back a little bit. There are two lines for municipal solid waste. The first one is the municipal solid waste tipping fees.
Mm-hmm.
Right, that's part of a 10-year contract that we have with
which is
waste management, yes, expansion. The second one is how we haul that municipal solid waste to the landfill and or to the site. And so we have been part of a trucking cooperative, a little subset of the Lamberg Regional Co-op, you know, the
small business cooperative.
Thank you, yes. So the trucking cooperative has been a small subset, 5 towns, and we've become increasingly unhappy with that cooperative. And we tried a couple of years ago to see if we could get out of it, but we were just underwater with the truck, the actual one asset of the cooperative. And so when we did the math, it didn't work. And unfortunately, what happened this year, 2018, is the driver, and it was just one driver, fell ill, and he's actually since passed away. But it caused the trucking cooperative to and what, you know, like, to revisit all of this. And we have dissolved the trucking cooperative. We put out a bid, you may have seen it on our website, we were looking for bids for the truck. And honestly, it went from 8,000 to 40,000. So thank God for that $30,000 bid. We sold it for 40,000. We were still underwater by about 1,700. I don't mean the town of Wellsville, the five towns. And the larger cooperative said, we're going to subsume that. Don't worry about it. So we are free and clear of any debt associated with the truck. But we still have to haul our stuff to the landfill. So in the meantime, we have been using Shipyard, who has been the hauler for our single stream recycling, but paying for it through the Lamper Regional Cooperative. So the Lamper Regional Cooperative hired them. And so we're not sure. We are now on the lookout. George is now, our road agent, is looking for ways to haul our municipal solid waste. We may actually, excuse me just a minute. We may actually be a little bit better off because we were paying mileage from the housing of the truck in Madbury to here, to Rochester, back here to return the canister, and then back to Madbury. So there was a lot of mileage. With another hauler, let's say Shipyard, who are doing routes within this area, this could just, you know, they could more efficiently bring it. So we might have less of a hauling charge because of that. So that's to the good on the municipal solid waste hauling line. However, we've also received letters from Shipyard regarding the recyclable hauling.
And the revenue for
trucking recycling?
Yes, trucking recycling. That has held steady at $275 a haul, and which is why we actually reduced the budget from 2017 to 2016, because you know it had been pretty stable. And if you do any general reading, you'll see that the recyclables commodities market is in trouble. And so what we've just received is a letter from Shipyard. They're not increasing their hauling charge, so it's still a $295 a haul, but they're giving us a surcharge on the tonnage of the recyclables. And so we're just finding this out, we're just doing the math, we don't know what it means, and hopefully by next quarter we'll be able to have more information on that. But that is, when you get your tax newsletter, you know, when you get your taxes, and you know, we get the town newsletter, there's going to be a little paragraph in there about residents, please don't put in the recyclables food debris. You know, if you've got a styrofoam, something with, you know, you didn't finish your French fries, you've got all that ketchup in there, please don't put it, you know, rinse, it doesn't have to be, like, washed, but please, like, rinse it out, put it in there. They're not accepting the plastic bags, Hannaford's, DeMoulas. That's why people like Hannaford's and DeMoulas, I think they're places for you to recycle. Please don't put that in our recyclables. So that's a little bit about what that message is going to say. What we just found out, is Judy still here? What we just found out is today Wednesday?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, is that we can't put pizza boxes in the cardboard. Is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Because
mm-hmm.
of the
grease.
Because of the food grease. So.
Is there potential that we could go back to sorting? And that would be the button, we'll buy it. That's one of these big issues with the recyclable commodities market is that single stream is like wrecking everything. So if we were to go back to sorting it ourselves.
Now, it doesn't have the cardboard. Cardboard, we're getting money for cardboard. Mm-hmm. We're managing that separately, and we do get money. But they also are saying no food debris, so
mm-hmm. right.
Can't be pizza boxes. With regard to whether we should go back to sorting things out, there are some expenses. We would need a baler for aluminum. We would get money for that, but we need a baler, which at the time
$5,000. I'm a numbers person. I would want to run the numbers. And if I ran the numbers, people might not, what if the numbers say that it's actually cheaper for us to put everything in the municipal solid waste thing?
Probably is.
Mm-hmm. And so, and then people say, oh, but you can't, we've got to recycle because that's the right thing to do. So those are some of the issues associated
well,
with that.
Well, I mean, if we're going to have a tonnage fee on the recycling, it's probably cheaper to put it in.
Well, it's a surcharge. We don't know yet what the anyway, surcharge is.
Right. Depending upon what that price is, so
right.
People may say the same thing yes. At some point.
But we did know when we went to single stream recycling that there was a drop in our municipal solid waste because it was easier for people, you know, who are getting a little busy or whatever, I don't want to, you know, to just put it down in one bin, you know, recyclable bin. So we thought we had done a good thing, and I think it was a good thing. But, you know, markets change. And you just have to be flexible and take a look at it and see what's going to work for us next. And that's something that we're looking at. So that is something for this committee to be thinking about with regard to the transfer station costs.
Yeah. Quick question. I still throw cardboard in my pizza box, and if it's a frozen one, like at Walmart.
As long as it has no debris.
As long as it has no grease in it, nothing.
Not anymore.
But they may not let you anyway just because they're going to sort of...
It's basically because if it gets dirty.
Particularly with paper products, if there's oils and greases on them, when they switch them together, then it contaminates the whole lot of it, is basically the problem. So if there are no greases or oils or debris on it, like if it's the outside packaging, you should be fine. Because they come in a plastic
bag. Right,
they
come in a plastic.
Totally, yeah.
No, that's
right.
Not true.
So we're veering from budget to interesting things, but let's veer back to...
I just had a few things to say. Estimated revenue, no particular surprises. We didn't have any deposit from our hydro dam, so we're checking with them. We did get one in April, so we don't know what the cycle is. This is a new operator for our hydro dam, so we're just going to find out what they're kind of what we might expect from it. But otherwise, revenues are doing okay. The building permit line may not show 25%. I don't know exactly what it shows, but we reduce the overall budget for building permits because the lots are being built on the Chinburg property. I know we did a lot this past week, so the first quarter is not the quarter where you're going to see most of your building permit activity. Anyway, so we're not really worried, but just looking at it. If you don't know, we've signed a contract with Pike for road work. It is just under $300,000, which is what we were planning for. Has a notice gone out yet on that?
I haven't seen it.
So we've drafted something. You should see it soon. That will say exactly what we're doing. So, you know, fresh off the press, or hot off the press, or whatever the phrase is. We are doing in the Woodlands reclamation from the beginning of Sligo up to the intersection of that other road there, is it River Run? Somewhere around
River Run.
River, yeah. Fully reclaimed, and then an overlay on the whole thing, and our own folks will be doing any ditching work that has to happen. So that's the Woodlands, it will be completed. Our other development of Roberts Farm, which is Heritage and Post's Car, we're reclaiming, we have to dig out that roller coaster that's at the beginning. It was filled, it's a fill site, and it has settled over the years. That's going to be dug out, repacked with stuff, they'll have some stabilization fabric, and they're reclaiming beyond that. The notice will say how far they go. So we will be doing some reclaiming in the Roberts Farm development on Heritage Drive at the beginning with a binder coat on all of that, and let what we really want is to have it. That roller coaster park settle for a year. Next year we'll go back and we'll do assuming that everything passes, we'll do a shim overlay on the entire development. So by the end of 2019, both of those developments should be improved. So
we're happy, you know, we're happy with that. Now, if you recall, the highway budget is 325. Excuse me. And our contract with Pike is like 298, 299, something like that. So we have some thoughts for that remaining, but we really have to wait and see how, you know, to see if there are any cost overruns. One of the issues could be fixing one of the culverts on Sligo Road. The one that we call the double culvert, and it is, if you know where the farm is, so if you're coming from Portland Avenue, there's the farm, there's the Charlie Putnam house, and there's the Aiken home. The culvert is sort of like in between those two, and there's a little dam right there. And it actually was I didn't know this until this year, finally figured out what they were talking about. It was, at first, a box granite culvert. And at some point, a road agent put a culvert in the middle of that, and it impeded the flow. It didn't allow the same amount. We don't know why this person did it. It was quite a while back. Maybe there were cracks in the granite. We have no idea. So we're having an engineer look at it. George is on top of it. What our engineer is going to do for us is right size. We're going to take out the box granite culvert and those. The second culvert that sits on top of that, which is completely ineffective, because by the time it drains water into the river, the road is already covered with water, so it's completely ineffective. So what we're doing is hiring an engineer to right size the culvert. We'll have a contractor, get close for a contractor to do it, and our highway department will do as much as they can. And we think that between the culvert money that we got this year, $10,000 of the various agency spend, and the difference between the Pike contract and the Mayor 25, that we may in fact be able to fix that culvert this year.
I have a quick question. Is there any money from the state we had from last year that we rolled over the highways?
That's part of the $325,000.
Okay.
We didn't spend any of it last year.
I know that.
Yeah. So that is...
That's in with it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Any other questions on the town budget we move on into?
Yeah.
Sorry.
Okay, I'm going to 977. Town supplies. That's at 49.6. Is that just because I bought ahead?
Yeah, we're not worried about it.
Okay.
It
should be a little bit
shorter. We have to do some work here. There was, remember the, I'll be okay.
I know.
Elections, was that wizard? So there's a lot of water in this room. And it rose up some of the tiles. We had to do some rework on the tiles, and nothing, it wasn't a leakage, it was just water that came in that day. And people were coming into horrible circumstances. So so we're not particularly religious.
And number 91 on town hall maintenance. What have we done for the mold?
That's it. That's the mold.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. So that's so we were still working on our infrastructure projects with the loans, if you recall, at the end of last year. And it took us until sort of late in the year before we figured we were going to be okay, you know, budgetarily. And so we did put off the mold until the beginning of January. So now it's in.
Okay, now the mold was for the police station, right?
It's for the mold remediation. Cleans out the ducts.
Okay, good. That was the thing that was interesting.
Yeah, throughout the entire building.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. Any other items people want to ask about the town budget before we move on to?
165.
Actually, I had that one on my list too.
Mutual aid.
Oh, yeah. I asked Caroline to look into that. I think it, some of that is probably under Hazmat Start, you know, which is like right
underneath it.
Yeah.
So we'll take a look at that and get that figured out.
It might just be
okay, thank you.
Yeah, I think it just needs to be reassigned. Because I doubt that our mutual aid went up doubled. I just don't believe that that happened. So so I think there's an issue, I don't know where it is, but we have asked Caroline to do it.
Thank you. That's it.
Bill?
Line 128, the police budget equipment.
Oh, yeah, Caroline's looking at that. Do you think it's actually an FY17 expense and shouldn't be there at all? So, because they haven't spent that, so we'll take a look at that.
I missed that one thing.
Yeah. It kind of jumps out, doesn't it?
It does.
Yes.
Any others?
I'll ask about dispatch, is that a one-time?
Where are you?
I'm right below, so I'm 37. Is that a fee?
Yeah, it is a one-time.
Okay.
I'm assuming the same thing with the ammo and the targets and the.
Yeah, yes, you know, they kind of order a bunch all at once, and so, and just generally speaking, the, you know, whether it's the nature of the business, I don't know, but fire and police, I've been on the board going on 6 years, they never overexpend their budget. So, and it actually helped us out in some cases, so. So I think we're going to be okay. And we had a scare with some vehicles, it happened just in the last 7 days. Where two of them sort of went on the fritz, and I won't give you the details, but it's good news on both of them, and it shouldn't be a, shouldn't be a budget crunch. So, we're good.
On line 175, is the road agent salary just higher than we have?
Well, there were three, there are three, no. No, but there were three payrolls in January. So they're every, you know, if you pay every other week. And so there are two bonus months. I always consider them bonus months anyway.
Totally. Those are my favorite ones.
Yeah, exactly.
Don't call that ahead.
The highway part-time staff, which is 177, is that because it's used more?
Which line is that?
177.
Well, okay, so 177, so you can see that we've reduced the budget on that line.
Yes.
And most of the expenditure, again, happens in the first quarter because.
That's what I figured, that's what I thought it was the plow.
Which doesn't mean to say we won't have, you know, an issue in the fall, depending on when winter decides to visit us.
End in November, right?
Pardon?
End in November, right?
If it doesn't come until next January, I'll be fine with it.
Emily's dying to start talking about this.
You guys have been like staying my execution, there's so many, you sure you don't have more questions?
I got a problem, my two sons are buying a house, they're putting together an offer tonight, and they have a meeting at 8:00, and I need to excuse myself, but I didn't know if I could do my budget next.
Look at this.
Do you want to watch that?
Again.
Please.
Yes.
I did not get the copy of that, that was going around.
Of what, the?
Water and sewer?
Water and sewer?
Yeah.
Got it.
Looks like this.
It was going around, here it is.
Yep.
If I can get back, I'll get back.
Did you get one?
Was that sent electronically as well?
I'm sorry?
Was that sent?
No, because we changed the format, and we changed a lot, because in the last week, we got a lot to happen at water and sewer.
I got one.
Dan St. Helier stepped down as a commissioner, and his wife stepped down, and the King, he's the treasurer, stepped down. So there's been a lot of fluttering, I should say, to try to make sure that everything's going okay. And it's going fine. I mean, we've got a lot of great people there now. I'll try to explain it in a nutshell. We've gone through, I've only been there 2 years, and what I've noticed is that we've had 3 or 4 operators, and what we've done is we've never really paid enough to get a good operator, and it's shown. And what happens is we get, you know, we get in trouble, we'll get close to in trouble with the state, and then the operator will wake up and be doing his work. And really, the operator needs to be on the ball, on the stick. And what happened over the last year and a half was we put together a better package for the operators, and now we've got better operators. That's basically what's happened. Has a lot of been safe? Yeah. I mean, have we been doing those things right? Yeah. But what we haven't been doing, that I learned when I came in, was we haven't been taking care of our 14-year-old plant. It was, the mentality was, well, we've got a new plant, we don't have to worry about anything. And that was so far from the case. You know, and the life expectancy of a plant is only about 20 years. And that's if you take care of it. And if you're not taking care of it, it's not good. So, realistically down the road, you know, I guess we prided ourselves in our budget is flat, it's not going up, let's move on to the next thing. And that's not what's been going on in the last, you know, 6 months or a year. We've really been looking at corrosion control for the town, because things are getting older. And, you know, certain streets are having problems, and it isn't just flushing that's going to take care of it. So we've got an engineering firm that we've got involved with that's looked at corrosion, and well, it is looking at corrosion. We got a $20,000 grant actually from the state. We pay 20, they pay 20, and we are moving forward to figure out how the new well and the old well are going to operate at different chemical levels so that your water's better. Once in a while we'll, you know, have a, they call it blowing the limit. 90% of all homes have to be 90% or better, you know, I'm sorry, I'll say that again. 90% of the homes when we test have to be within the limit. And we've always been, you know, just over that. And that's not good enough. We want to be looking for 100%. And what we're finding is that the older homes that have lead and copper piping tend to blow the limit, even though you supply them good water, the water's good, it's not the best. So what we're trying to do is we're trying to figure out what makes it the best so that your pipes don't leach lead and copper and blow limits. So that's part of the studies that we're doing. So if you look at that's what's going on at Water and Sewer. I mean, it's time to, unfortunately, get with the...
realistic.
Yeah, and you can't go 14 years without an increase, and you know, and have insurance go up and this go up and that go up, and not, you can't do that. That's the problem. So, unfortunately, next year the budget's probably going to be a little bit more, and it's just the way it is. So, so I don't know if you want to look at the sewer first. We're at 29, oh, we have a new way to look at this. You've got 2016, 17, and 18. And if you'll look, the bottom line budget was always the same, which that raises an eyebrow with me. I don't think that that's realistic, but let's go through it. Can look at the big items that seem to be off. And the first one that kills me is maintenance and repairs of the plant. And what happened there is, luckily, we had an insurance for $21,000 of a big freeze-up that we had at the plant. The boiler system that runs where the influent is, it froze up when we had that really cold spell. Mm-hmm. But again, if we had a program in place that was better with the equipment, this probably wouldn't have happened. So, you know, there's antifreeze that's put in the systems, but that antifreeze needs to be checked or replaced on a regular basis. And I found no program in place that was doing that. So that's, all the other things, I mean, we're in pretty good shape. If you look at capital expense principle, that's for the bond, and it's just the timing of the bond, so we're not, that's going to be right, that's not going to be a problem.
Can you explain what that means? I don't understand that, I'm sorry.
The capital expense for the principal of the plant and capital expense, it's that we have bonds for, like, for instance, the plant that was put in, so we have to make a bond payment.
Got it.
Two times or four times a year.
Okay, got it.
And this fell so that it was like an extra.
It fell so there was an extra payment, so that's what.
Got it, okay, thank you.
What other questions on this one?
I see electric is high, is that similar to what Suzanne was saying, that the rates are just going up?
No, that's, the issue with that is we have an arsenic removal system. And when we brought in the new superintendent, previous superintendents have been like afraid to run that well too much because it's so complicated. But we're supposed to be getting water from both places in pretty equal amounts. We're running that well more, and there's more electricity associated with it. But it's important to exercise that well because, and the good news actually is we've had the lowest numbers for arsenic in, I think, since we started. And the operator figured that out. The new superintendent figured out how that was working, how to make that work better. And we actually had engineering money set aside to figure that out. And before we spent it, we figured it out.
That's great. That's great.
So he's a super go-getter. Came from Dover. Worked under Reaganet.
Vermette.
And
Ray speaks hot. Ray Vermette speaks very highly.
Yeah, we're so lucky to have this guy. But bottom line was, we got to spend a little bit more money to get somebody that wants to stick around. So, any other questions on this page?
My question is that you will probably be living within the budget anyway, correct?
We're trying to live within the budget here. What we also ran into is the state required. I don't believe that we're going to blow the budget. If we do, we do have contingency money, but we really hope that that's not going to happen. We're putting together a 5- to 10-year plan in the future to try to, you know, see what, you know, how we're going to take care of the plant the right way.
The point is, next year,
next year you're going to be seeing.
One of the goals here is that we're trying to see what for the next budget, and what you're warning us is it's probably.
I'm warning you that it's, yeah, because here's the next talk about it. You've got the sewer side and you've got the water side, and on the sewer side, we're basically one operator lower than what the state recommends. And how that has been able to be okay for all these years, I don't understand. But I met with the state and spoke to them, and my superintendent did, and we came up with, you can't do what you have to do with that number of people.
Right.
So that's what.
So the likelihood you'll be hiring a new person?
We before Dan left and before Mike left, we all voted to hire another person.
And this is just a projection and question, but I'm on both water and sewer. So what are you thinking when you're hiring a whole other person and plant issues? And I mean, what's your thought on what the increase would be?
We don't know what it's going to be, but we're ratepayers too, you know. So I'm trying to balance it, of course. I don't suspect it's going to be anything big. I don't think it's going to be more than maybe $10 or $20 a quarter. We're not looking at. You know, we're just looking at
improvement.
Yeah. So on the water side,
that's supply and equipment.
We bought a year's amount. And things had changed, the way that we were, what's happening is when things change, you can't predict how the wells are gonna operate. So that was basically a major change that occurred.
So there'll be a total overage in that?
Absolutely, absolutely. Let's see. Same thing with electric, you see that's high?
Black line, that was your 22%?
Yeah.
So, pretty much on.
Yeah.
And any big projects this summer?
Yeah, that's what I guess you know about that. We had a few things happen. Hydro, I know you mentioned hydro. Hydro usually doesn't use much water, but apparently a valve was left down, and instead of a $193 bill, they have a $31,779 bill. In the transition of bringing on a new
operator,
we started seeing that it was difficult with the regular schedule to keep the water level where it needed to be in the tanks. And so we started looking for water breaks. We couldn't find any water breaks. When we read the meters, we figured out where the water was going. And someone had left open a valve and they had owned up to it for 3 weeks, and they pumped that much water. So what happens though is when something like that crazy happens is you send out an estimated bill, and then you do the research. So we did the research last year at the same time, this year, how much did everything run, and unfortunately the hydro used that much water.
What was their response?
We're waiting for a response. They just got a letter. We just sent the letter to them saying, hey, this is what we did. We did the research. Their operator knew about it, knew that there was a problem, that there was a bill coming, because we went in there 3 times. So that's going to be, who pays that bill?
So I don't know exactly how that's going to work its way out.
Yeah.
What we get, we own it, what we get is revenue based on the electricity that's generated. So this may legally be their own loss. I mean, we'll have to see if they send a letter to us or make demands of us, it may go to legal.
Yeah, that just happened. That letter just went out this week.
Yeah, so we'll see. Yeah. We haven't heard.
And unfortunately, when valves fail, when the meters fail, they always fail in one direction. They read less, not more. But it was a recent meter, so it wasn't. And when they found the valve open, they said, "Ooh." So a couple things that are going on. We've got a huge generator that we run at the plant when the power goes out, and it's 3-phase, and it's very expensive, and it only has 300 hours on it, but it's got a diesel leak. And you can't just call and get the diesel generator worked on. You have to have a backup there the second that you take the thing offline. So the big expense is going to be the backup when we bring that down. That's happening. Another thing I wanted to mention, we're trying to stay competitive. We've had a lot of turnover. I think I mentioned that, 3 or 4 superintendents in 7 years. So I feel pretty good. We changed our hiring policies and our pay scale so that we've got a 10-year scale plan. Cost of living, 2%. You know, nothing crazy.
Something known, in other words, that the operator
right,
can.
Right. So they know where they're going to be going, and that tends to bring in people that are more long term. In the past, it's been, well, you know, we like you and we're going to give you more, and we don't like you as much, or that's gone. That's changed. We have set rules that way.
That's for 2019, though? Or?
No, 18.
Oh, 18.
That's 18.
Okay.
That's Saturday this year. Spoke about that. Oh, technology. Where the new superintendent's very close to the state. He wants them to know what we're doing and how we're doing it. And because of that, we've got a lot of new electronic equipment that we're able to report directly to the state with instead of manual stuff. So, I shouldn't say a lot of equipment, but we have some equipment, but in in keeping with that, we have to pay for some data use and whatnot to be able to do that. So you're taking your data directly at the site, it's going directly to the state, and there's no chance of it being manipulated, not
reported incorrectly.
Exactly the way it is, yeah, so. What else do I have? Just a note, when you look at the two items, you've got basically almost a $596,000 budget. What you'll see is that you'll see the same things. You'll see something like personnel. And or here's a perfect example. Line 22 is prop share administration, and line 24 on the second page is prop share administrative. What's happening is it's the same category, but a percentage of it goes to the water and a percentage of it goes to the sewer. So whenever you see anything like that, that means it's, you know, it's percentage. We talked about more operators. That's it. That's all I've really got. I mean, I apologize for maybe not having all the information you guys need, but it's my first swag at this one.
Do you have time for like a 30-second comment?
Sure.
First, I empathize, and I'm sure my whole board would empathize with exactly what you're talking about. And sometimes, you know, you're in a position where you're having to do things that maybe should have been done all along, and it's just a difficult state to be in, and I appreciate the Water and Sewer District and trying to come to grips with that. The other thing is, and if you don't know it, I think you will or soon will, and that is we the board support anything that our road agent and Highway Department can do to help with regard to work, as long as Water and Sewer can supply the materials. And George has said that to us, and so I'm sure he's mentioned that to
us. I saw that, and I know, like, in the winter when your trucks were down, I asked the new superintendent, I said, how did it go? He's like, well, I plowed the streets for about 7 hours because they had no trucks.
So,
and
that's
I agree,
the
yeah, and
then that's
stuff
exactly
helped us.
The way we would love to operate, yeah. And so we're happy to have this.
Yeah, there's been, I understand there's been a wall in the past, and I think the wall is down.
So and that's a great that's thing.
Yeah, and we appreciate it. So, and I guess we're going to address the when we're addressing the street repairs, when you're addressing street repairs, we'll coordinate that a lot better.
Yes, absolutely. Mm-hmm. At the moment, all we know for sure is the development of this year and finishing up Heritage, we'll for next year. But as soon as we get, we'll let you know when the public hearing is, so that you guys can come and listen to what we have. The next thing on the list is supposed to be the village, but there may be a reason why we postpone that. So, but we'll keep you posted when we have some information to share.
I mean, I don't want to come off, you know, all gloomy that, you know, we have to make all these changes, but I think we just need to look a little bit ahead, and we really haven't been, and we've had the luxury that the budget has been. You know, if you look back, it was, you know, $40,000 of extra in 2016 in water, and then and that came back as a, it's an item, what do you call that? The
reserve balance sheet balance?
No, it's called the, we're able to spend that the next year. And you have
revolving?
No, it's not, it's different, it works differently than with you folks. It's called a...
It's not fund balance.
No, it's, we have a bottom line balance, and we have a bottom line budget, but we are able to create a warrant article to be able to use that money in the next year. So, you know, what's been good about what's happened in the past is we had to put in a well. We had to put in a new well, and that was last year, and that well was $160,000. The $40,000 or so that was left over and left over and left over allowed us to put in a well and not increase the tax base. So, you know, kudos to everybody for doing that. The issue is we haven't staffed the way that we should, and we've been lucky that we haven't violated or had problems that we could have had. And in talking with the state, there were things that basically where we're at was the state had been putting a lot of pressure on the sewer district saying, hey, you've gone through too many operators. What's going on? So that's why we keep head wake up and do the things that we gotta do. So.
Do you need to get going, Frank?
I do. My kids are doing a purchasing a house together, so I'll be back if I can.
Good luck.
Thank you.
All right.
Does anybody have any other questions?
Crossing our fingers, we still won't be here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Does anybody have any other questions on the budget? No?
No, nice job. Thank you, Frank.
Thanks, Mike.
Thank you.
I can't wait any longer.
Okay. So, school budget. As you all know, we're on a little different schedule than most of you. So, what you received was the third quarter budget. We're now a month past that. But the budget you guys are looking at is a pretty healthy balance between encumbered and spent funds. We were at 94.2%. A month later, we're at 95%, which is just fine. Special education is still like a big unknown, and accounts for about half of what we have encumbered for the year. We still have utilities and such that aren't currently encumbered. So while so we still have plenty of money left to spend, is what I'm saying. So it's what, $332,000 is our current available balance. What else do you want to know? We have we're still talking with Marshwood about because the special ed the way we get our bills from Marshwood for special education is still causing us a little bit of confusion as far as what we're spending and how we're spending. So we're continuing discussions with them, but this year it's definitely been a lot more accurate than it was last year. So we are happy with how things are going, but those discussions continue so that we can get more accurate as we are more comfortable with the relationship. I have some like what we're expecting for next quarter. Should I go right into that, or would you prefer to ask some questions about what you have in front of you?
Why don't you go forward, and if we got any questions, we can answer them one either.
I can do that too. All right. So some stuff that we have planned for this budget was we had a grant that we proposed to the state. There was a bunch of money released from the state to do safety and security measures at schools. They put out a deadline, and we met that deadline, and it turned out that they actually had so many requests in that they said, wait, hold on, we're backing up that deadline a little bit, so if you put it in before this date, we're going to give it to you. But if you put it in after that date, but before the original deadline, we still have to review it. So that is under review, but we do.
So you missed it. You missed it, what you're
saying.
So
we missed
the window that you didn't know about.
The window that we didn't know about, exactly. But we made the window we did know about, which is a little bit frustrating, but it is what it is. So that total is $63,000. And we have it available in our budget now, so we're going to go forward with the work and hope that we could get up to 80% of that reimbursed to us. Depending, they are our kind of read on it is that they're seeing whether, because you have to come up with some of the money yourself, there were a lot that were, you know, hundreds of thousands of dollars. So the town has, these other places need to make sure that they can come up with their portion in order to take the portion from the state. So we're guessing that perhaps they're waiting to see if there's going to be even more money left in projects that don't get done, that they've funded. Yeah.
Whether you got the grant or not, you still have to pay the $63,000 up front.
Yes, exactly. Yep. Yeah. then we would get reimbursed, hopefully. So we're going to go ahead with the projects, which includes the safe and secure doors that we have been hoping for a long time, a new telephone system that will allow for better communication within the school, and the intercom system. Am I missing anything, Judy?
No.
I think that's it.
That's pretty much it.
Okay. So that is something that we're planning to spend out of this year. Another thing that happened that will affect this year's budget is that we have been informed that we will likely lose our Title I adequacy funding from the state for next year, which is a bad thing as much as it's a good thing, because most of it's a big formula, but it is largely dependent on how many children in the school are qualifying for free and reduced lunches. Means many less children need to take part in the free and reduced lunch program of our school, so that means our families are doing well, but at the same time it means we lose a lot of funding. So along with that program came lots of supplies that the state funded, federal government funded, excuse me. If we don't get any of the funding next year, we'll have to box up all those supplies, put them in a closet, and inventory them and not touch them, regardless of whether we need them.
Property of U.S. government.
Exactly. So, however, we still have children in the school that need these resources and need this help. So, we have allocated encumbered $13,000, which is what the principal has told us is basically the bare minimum that we need to help these students succeed. We're putting it in this year's budget because we have it in this year's budget. We can use it in, you know, the remainder of May and June, and then we'll have it for next year. If we were to get our Title I funding back again the following year, we can then take all those boxes out of storage and reuse the materials. If not, we ship them back. If we get $1,000 of Title I funding, we'll be able to use those materials, but we won't know that potentially until after our budget closes for the year.
And what kind of materials are we talking about?
Books, iPads, technology that is used is for reading specialists' work, basically. Yeah.
If we don't get the money, can we just tell the feds come and get it? We're not shipping it.
Yeah. Well, I was like, can we charge some storage? Yeah. So that's another slightly frustrating thing that we all, I think, took probably a half an hour of our meeting to wrap our minds around, like, how that could possibly be a thing. But anyway, it is what it is again. Some good news is that the board voted to put all of our non-union personnel onto the same healthcare plan as the union staff is. So that should save about $12,000 over for next year. So offsetting our Title I materials fund. And then we're doing a bunch of work over the summer. The roof will get, per the warrant article that was passed last year, the roof of the annex will be resurfaced over the summer. And the cupola that is falling apart and falling down will be repaired beginning in June. And then we have all this, the safe and secure doors and stuff that I talked about earlier. And the garden committee also helped with donating two trees that will be planted over the summer with Wentworth Garden, Wentworth Greenhouses. And they planted by Phipps Landscaping.
Phipps Landscaping is donating the labor.
The labor.
And the house is donating trees. And the children were involved, I believe, in the selection of the two trees.
Yes, that's right. They voted.
And this is part, if you're not aware, this is part of the tree initiative with the garden club. We have this GLSC, but we're also in the garden club. And it's when Robin Aikman joined our board that we started this tree initiative. There are trees on Main.
Main Street that we've planted.
Fire Station.
Fire Station, Gordon Park, and now two that are going at RGS, so.
That's very cool.
I'd love to see the community threaded together in any possible way that we can. That's why I love the cooperation with the Water and Sewer District. It's all good stuff.
Great.
What kind of tree?
What do they choose?
Linwood?
Yeah.
Linden.
I wasn't there.
Linwood.
One linden and one.
What's the other one? It's a weird name.
But they're both shade trees.
Oh, sour?
Yes.
Sour, yeah.
Sour something.
Sour something.
Two trees I've never heard of before.
One by the post office, the third one will go by the post office.
That's excellent.
Yeah. Do your worst.
No.
My question is about the warrant articles you have that say, if we have this money left over, we'll add it. Will any of that be?
We expect to, yes.
And it's special ed or?
Special ed and then.
No, not special ed.
No.
Building.
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 $75,000.
Oh, we didn't put in special ed this year.
$75,000 for the building.
Thank you, Charlie.
And $1.
And $1 for the.
A new fund.
The new fund for capital.
So you're expecting.
Tuition, yeah, tuition.
Oh, tuition fund, sorry.
$75 to capital improvements.
Thank you.
$1 just to the tuition fund that we just started.
And the roof.
I get it.
And the roof. Well, the roof was.
The roof was a warrant.
Yeah.
The roof was straight up, give us the money.
So the point you're making is that the excess is going to go into this?
Oh, yeah.
Yes, the warrant was written such that if the operating budget has $75,000 left, it will go into this building fund. So I was just wondering whether they thought that they would be able to do that.
We do expect to be able to do that.
Thank you. Any other questions for Charlie?
How much you expecting to have left over? I know it's a difficult question.
I don't have a number for you on that. We think that we will have more than the $75,000 that we're going to be putting in. I don't know how much more though, sorry.
It's not the end of the month.
Any other questions?
You're anticipating probably around $151,000 from what you're setting aside so far, and I believe that's not including the $30,000 you had already set aside for the bells and.
I don't think we're anticipating. At the moment, we're not anticipating. We're simply not anticipating. There's too much out.
The 30 was encumbered, but we have, you know, we have a lot left of the school year. I mean, not as much as the town, obviously, or the Water and Sewer District, but there's a lot left. I certainly don't feel comfortable giving a number to it.
2317, the audit, that was $1,250 over. It's on the front page, I just.
That's just the actual cost of the audit.
Okay, what it cost?
It's been done, and that was what it cost, so.
And the other question was, 2630, the maintenance, $19,000 over. Is there a reason?
That's because we encumbered the money for the doors, and the money we had not encumbered already, we encumbered later in the year. So that's why we're over there.
Okay, you moved it over there.
Yeah.
Make sure that it's okay with you.
It is okay.
It's certainly okay with me.
I'm sorry. Emily is throwing her voice over here. I'm so sorry.
I know, it's hard.
Good information, not a problem. I'll hold it against you.
For me to come to the table and support, I mean, that would be okay.
I just wanted to be respectful of our chair.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, I'm respectful.
As I said, if you can do things productively, a little less formally, that's okay. If it gets so it's not productive, then we'll be more formal.
Sorry.
And 2060, English is the second language. You haven't spent any, and it's non-incumbent?
No, I would expect that unless we have a new student come to the school that requires those services, we probably won't use them.
Okay, good.
general question. I don't know if you know this, but did you, what was your flux in students? I know you have the coming in, coming out, coming in, coming out.
I have to look at my last board packet, but I think we're up a couple.
We're up a couple.
From last month.
We're not back up to where we started the year.
Right.
But we're in about the 155, 156 range right now. With a large kindergarten class expected to start next September.
Right, yeah.
And a large one this year, as we know.
Large one this year.
So we have a bubble now starting to go through.
Sean, I say something.
Yeah.
So the board, just at last week's meeting, the select board got a report from the Department of Employment Security, which is like a weird place to come from, but they have a lot of statistics. They sent us this report that's available online, I've looked at it, and they have age groupings, and the age group of 0 to 5 in the town of Rollinsford is pretty high. So I'm not surprised that you have a big kindergarten class and maybe expecting another big kindergarten class. So it's interesting to look at that.
Yeah, anecdotally, I definitely know of a lot of younger people with younger children that have moved into the area, into the town for sure.
One more quick question. For the next meeting, could you give me the total compensation for the new principal?
Yes. Yes, we will have it by then.
We will not be including his health because that's a HIPAA regulation.
Oh, right.
Yeah, but what you usually do is you usually black it out and then you put a total of what they their total compensation on the side.
So yeah, I'm not sure that we'll have it by the next. Oh, maybe by August we'll have it.
Because I know it's going to be less than this one.
I'll figure out
that's
what we can.
If it's not that one, the next
one. How do you know
one.
That?
What?
How do you know that?
Because you guys said it at the last
school board
meeting.
Why would I go to all these meetings? I pick a little up everywhere.
It was said at the last school board meeting.
It will be less.
I don't want to get into the whole guidelines and reviewing them right now. It's already 30. I'm not sure I understand.
Probably we'll need another meeting for that or something too.
Yeah, I'm not totally sure I understand the purpose of the guidelines, to be honest, and where we're. So I guess it's a bigger discussion than starting at 30. But if you want to just talk a little bit about them and what we're hoping for, but not necessarily get to a point where we're voting on or finalizing.
This will just be sort of an approaching comment.
Okay.
That is that, as is true with any board, commission, committee, whatever, the actions of one board, committee, commission do not bind the next year or the next board, committee, commission, whatever. So the guidelines as they existed last year don't really pertain to us unless we make them pertain to us or want them to pertain to us. My other comment about them, other than the obvious one about the capital issue, which we found out really is not the business of the budget committee, but my other one is it seems way too detailed, you know, how to run a meeting, how to this and that. And it seems to me, you know, based on what we thought, you know, what, and remember how you said it would be great to have something as chair. You know, I think a handbook is a helpful thing. We think of something as a handbook. Like, you know, we need to, you know, this is what we need to do every year. This is, you know, public hearings require this much notice. Regular meetings hold this much notice. You know, a handbook for a chair, vice chair, whatever, and committee members so that, you know, we know what we're supposed to do and how we're supposed to do it. But not necessarily that, you know, one has to call call for a point of order for this or a point of information for that or, you know, these kinds of things. Those are my overarching comments.
I think the intent was, I know when I first joined the budget committee, it was like, okay, what do I do now?
Yeah.
You walk in and it's like, and only by being here for length of time that you sort of, by osmosis, you know, pick up what we're doing, it would be something like a guidebook or a handbook that says, this is our reason for being. This is, you know, briefly, concisely, not long and drawn out, but just, this is what we're doing. Mm-hmm. And that's what I think it should be. And I agree with you, we should avoid the minutia and, you know, all the other stuff that I think maybe we fell into in the past, including myself. And have just sort of a broad brush. This is what it is. This is what we do, and these are the dates and so forth we have. So I think it's just sort of a guideline for us, and especially new people coming in, to say this is what you got yourself into, because nobody knows. You know.
No, I found it useful to look at because I was looking for anything to sort of get a sense for what I was committing to.
Yeah, and you don't know.
Little did I know I'd be committing to being a chair.
And what happened last year is we were halfway into it, and everybody said, well, we're already halfway there, so this should be for the next budget committee. And then we get to the next budget committee, and it's like, well, we're not bound by the last budget committee, but the fact is we need something.
Something to...
And we just keep, it keeps getting kicked down the road, and it should be addressed one way or the other. It's just dangling out.
I think there are some items in there that we aren't during training that probably are more like establishing almost like a regulatory thing or a rule which we can't do. Like we're here to prepare a budget essentially, and our meetings now are to make sure we can prepare a new budget next time. That's essentially what we're doing. But there are some sort of specifics about what's capital and what's not capital, and that's really not in our purview. It's pretty clearly in the governing board's purview.
The only thing that came out, if I might add, that was helpful was your question, Bill. You know, because of how, you know, Attorney Burns articulated something, you said, well, does that mean that we're like sitting down and actually putting in all the individual figures? And the answer came back, at least the way I understood, no, what we're doing is perfectly fine in how most towns do it. You know, the town, you know, prepares an initial budget, including, you know, police and fire and whatnot. You, because they're important and larger than others, you also speak to the police and fire. So the way we're doing, our process for doing it, my understanding is has just been fine.
I felt after her presentation that we were pretty much right on track with what we're supposed to be doing.
Except for the capital items.
Yeah. But all the other stuff, I was pretty comfortable and happy with, okay, yeah, we're doing this right. This is good. So we seem to be on the right track, I think.
What we'd love to do, we the board, is have more time to examine some of the other accounts that she talked about, like revolving accounts and expendable trust funds, because it may help us do things in a, you know, put together an operating budget that, you know, that doesn't have things like the recreation fees that could be paid for by a revolving fund. It's just, you know, where do we find the resources, human and financial, to make that happen? I don't know. But I think there are some opportunities there for us to do some things.
Does it make sense to have a committee of this group sit down and take what we have and pull together that sort of handbook that we're talking about that has those key things that help people pull together, or could we sit down in a group of 13 people and try and hammer it out?
Would you like my opinion?
Sure.
I think a committee of 12 who tries to design a horse comes out with something that doesn't look at all like a horse. So, you know, I think a subgroup is a fine idea. Even if one person wanted to take a stab and then
last year
put it together, you know. It's, you know, if I weren't so constricted in what I currently am able to do at the moment, both
you know, it's the kind of stuff that I really like to do. Having come from the information technology world, I understand how good documentation, how helpful good documentation is and good processes. I can't make that offer at the moment, right? So it would have to come from somewhere else.
Bill started a really good start this year.
I'll try it again. And I'll try to pull it together and, you know, circulate it. And, so we don't need to be as specific as it is.
Right. Yeah, there's a lot of like roles and how to conduct meetings and
that's... And there's a lot of redundancy from the RSA. It doesn't be there because it's already in the RSA. Right. So.
Exactly.
But don't you think that new people that are coming to the committee should know where to look for those RSAs?
Sure.
Well, we can reference them.
Yeah, we'll reference RSA. Rather than
reading them all out.
I'm happy to, I do a lot of technical writing, so if you want, I'm happy to take a look at that when you...
Sure.
I think the biggest problem is to fill a vacancy.
Yeah.
The RSAs are very clear that the Budget Committee can appoint a vacancy.
Yeah.
In any way the Budget Committee chooses to do it. It does not say anything else.
Yeah. I
just saying. That's not the point I was trying to make.
But the argument was what we were choosing to do. Right. It was a divided.
Yeah.
I mean, that was the problem.
So we and I mean, if we say in the guidebook, you know, if we want to say if there's a vacancy, it will be replaced by, you know, the vote of the Budget Committee. We don't have to reference the next highest vote getter or do any of that.
Which we don't think it does now. I think it just says that. It's just the same thing.
It just reflects the RSA meeting.
Yeah.
That, which is what I was going to say. We can't put together something that contradicts the RSA.
Right.
And the RSA is the law under which we are operating. What we would like the handbook to do is just say, look, you know, we need to set up a schedule at the beginning of the year. You know, the Municipal Association or the DRE could be resources to set out the calendar, you know, because they could be changes. So we could put something in there, and it could change from year to year. We're always tweaking SB2, as we found out. So, you know, just the kinds of things that you might have wanted to know at the time, how we conduct our meetings. I mean, there's no RSA, and the same is true for the board. There's no RSA that says we have to follow Robert's rules, we have to follow, you know, Hilda's rules. There's nothing in there about that. And what our board has done, and we're, it's a lot easier because we're a board of three. So we will do some things just by consensus, you know, it's just how do we feel about this. As long as it's not contract or money, you know, we'll just use consensus and move on. I don't know how possible it is with the, you know, group size, but still.
Good. That was the last item that I had, so we have a motion to adjourn.
Wait a second.
Is Ed James an Army?
Is this what they talked about at the meeting?
Yeah. I believe so. That's what they put
out. Was there a more current version than the 2012 that we have?
There is.
Oh, sure there is.
Okay.
I don't
know. That's the question.
So, okay. Sorry. Is
he unexcused?
Sorry?
Is he unexcused?
He's unexcused.
Okay.
I did call Ed after our last meeting, and I think I shared that by email to talk to him, and he came to the training too.
Yes,
and he's planning to be on. I think his wife has been ill off and on, and he's been having to sort of do stuff maybe unexpectedly, so that's the situation there.
So maybe if we could get current versions of that. Because we didn't go to the meeting, we didn't go to the class.
Yeah, there were slides.
I was surprised that she did not bring books for us, to be honest with you.
Yeah,
so
they charge you for that.
They charge for that, yes. Yeah. So I do have one at home because I was signed up to go to last September's meeting that I had an occurrence of what I'm currently having and didn't go. So I can bring that in, at least share it. But we can also check to see how much it costs and we'll see what we can do. The other thing I wanted to make sure the Budget Committee understands is there is, in September, a full workshop on basic law budgeting, municipal budgeting. It's in Concord, though, and so for people who work, it can be difficult. But if someone wants to go, just please request it of the board. I feel, I'm not the board, so I can't guarantee it, but I feel sure the board, I feel optimistic that the board would be amenable to paying both the fee and the and gas mileage for people who wanted to go. Another thing that I think, even though I will not be on any future boards, but it seems to me would be a very good idea for the board to continue to do every 3 years or so what we did this past last week. You know, it's a good review. You know, it's a good review. And
just for Charlie and Nancy's sake, it was, she said, I'm going to give this presentation in 2 hours, which is usually a full day. And so she picked out the highlights of what, but the full day, you'd probably get a lot more.
Yes, and usually they have some special topics in the afternoon. The time I went, they were just coming out with Obamacare, and so there were some special topics on how to manage that in the municipality, especially a larger one than ours. So, but yes, it's always, it is helpful. I think we can at least get our slides. I think I saw them on my desk.
Yeah, she gave us, she had a handout of the slides.
So I can get slides copied and give them to everybody.
On the PowerPoint.
Yes, exactly.
So do we have a motion to adjourn?
I would make such a motion.
I'll second.
All in favor?
Aye, you betcha.
I wouldn't feel, Bill, I know you wanted to.
So, where is the recording going to be posted so I can see how stupid I'm looking?
Well, my postings go up on YouTube on Rollins Food Videos. It will be up within probably 24 hours. And Rollins Food Videos is one word when we type it in.
Have a good night, sorry, I coughed on you. You don't get it.
Feel
I know.
Thank you.
Yeah. Good night.
Good seeing you.
Good night.